I heard an old story.
Thank you for tuning in to the television ministry of Clay's Mill Baptist Church. Join us as we share our passion for soul winning, spiritual growth, and revival in our state and nation. And now, Pastor Jeff Fugate.
Good evening and welcome to the program tonight. Thank you so much for watching. My family and I appreciate the opportunity and the time that we have to be with you on Saturday evening. And we appreciate those that watch by way of Facebook and share our program to your personal page, multiplying the opportunity we have to give the gospel and to preach the Word of God. The most important decision anyone will ever make in this life is the decision to recognize that we are all fallen in sin and in need of a Savior. Have you ever thought, friend, about the fact that our bodies are fallen? Our natures are fallen. There's something wrong. There is a dying that is set in. And I trust you're healthy and feeling good, but the truth is we move closer to death every day. Some live to be what young people call old. But I never preach a funeral where folks say, I was just glad to die, and I was glad for them to die. Ah, friend, life, it ends in death, and it's always, as the Bible describes it, as a vapor. It appears for a little time, and then it vanisheth away. You see, we're fallen. Our nature is fallen. You see, Satan entered the garden. God had put Adam and Eve in the garden, and he told them in the Garden of Eden that they could enjoy all that he had placed there. He told them, however, in the midst of the garden, there was a tree of knowledge of good and evil. And he told them, I don't want you to eat of that fruit. If you eat of that fruit, ye shall die. That's what he said, ye shall die. You know the story. Satan entered the garden and he spoke to Eve first, and he said, hath God said? And he said, you'll not die. And he contradicted God and he deceived Eve, and she took of the fruit, and then Adam took of the fruit. And the Bible says, wherefore as by one man sin entered into the world and death by sin, so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. You see, we have a fallen nature because of sin in the Garden of Eden. However, God, before the foundation of the world, designed salvation's plan for all to be redeemed from sin, and he prepared for them a home in heaven. Now for Satan, he prepared a lake of fire. He prepared the place called hell. Hell is prepared for the devil and his angels. It's not prepared for people. The Lord is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. You say, preacher, is everybody going to heaven? No. Sadly, there are many who reject Christ's payment for their sin. And there are many in their rejection of Christ choose to go to the eternal damnation where the devil has been sentenced for all eternity. I'm glad Satan has been condemned to eternal death. I'm glad because of his deception and his work. But how sad it is that God's creation of mankind would not accept God's price paying for their sin and redeeming their soul, giving to them eternal life. There are many illustrations in the Bible about salvation and how that salvation is free. The Bible talks about in Revelation 3:20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man will open the door, he said, I'll come in and I'll sup with him. He talks about receiving just a glass or a cup of water. And salvation is like receiving a glass of water. It's very simple, friend, to know Christ as Savior. You see, we must understand that we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. But God, not willing that any should perish, he gave his only begotten Son to die on the cross. And whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. When I was just a lad of a boy, less than 6 years old, I prayed a simple prayer and I said, "Dear Lord, I realize I'm a sinner. Please forgive me of my sin. I accept your payment on Calvary. I accept your payment on the cross as payment for my sin. I receive you as my personal Savior. To the best of my ability, the best of my knowledge as a child, I put my faith and trust in Christ, and according to the Bible, He gave me eternal life." Many times I've asked folks, "Are you 100% sure you're going to heaven?" And most of the time folks say, "I don't think you can know for sure." But the Bible says in 1 John 5:13, "These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that you have eternal life." The Bible said, if we believe, we have everlasting life. If we reject, if we believe not, we do not have eternal life and will not see heaven. Friend, has there been a time you asked Jesus to be your Savior? You say, "Preacher, I don't know if I can live it." Folks, that's beside the point of salvation. That's beside the point. Salvation is receiving Christ's payment for our sin. We ought to strive to live a life that's pleasing to God. But the Bible doesn't say good people go to heaven and bad people go to hell. The Bible says believers go to heaven and rejecters go to hell. Those that don't believe. Perhaps tonight, at this very time, you ought to say, "Lord, I realize I'm a sinner. Forgive me of my sin. Come into my heart and save me. I accept you as my personal Savior. And I accept the gift of eternal life." Friend, if you'll pray that prayer according to the Bible, believing it in your heart, there's no magic in the words we say, but we believe in our heart. We confess with our mouth. The Bible says in Romans 10 and verse number 13, you shall be saved. That's what this broadcast is all about. That's why for these many years, we've been putting this program on every Saturday evening to give the gospel of Christ. If you have a friend that perhaps has not received Christ as Savior, you could send this program to them and say, "Just watch and listen as the preacher explains salvation." I'm going to go to a song and have my family to sing, and then after this song, I'll give you the message for this evening, and then we'll come back with a closing song that you'll enjoy.
For making the sun to shine, putting the stars in the sky, for the flowers that bloom, the ocean so blue, thank you, Lord. For the sparrow that sings and makes sweet melody, for the rivers that flow, the rain and the snow, thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord, for everything you've done for me. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord, for making me whole, saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for my whole family, for the joys you've given me, for shoes on my feet, plenty to eat. Thank you, Lord, for the church where I worship and pray, for the freedoms that I have today. Your spirit I feel, your presence so real. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord, for everything you've done for me. Thank you. to thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord, for making me whole, saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole, saving my soul. Thank you, Lord.
I'm preaching tonight from the book of Matthew in chapter 24. There are two words that are common in my vocabulary, working and watching. Those two words are common in my vocabulary because they're common in the Word of God. I'm going to read a few verses from Matthew chapter 24 and then preach for a few minutes on the subject, watching and working. Matthew 24, verse number 42, "Watch therefore, for you know not what hour your Lord doth come. But know this, that if the goodman of the house had known in what watch the thief would come, he would have watched and would not have suffered his house to be broken up. Therefore, be ye also ready, for in such an hour as ye think not, the Son of Man cometh. Who then is a faithful and a wise servant, whom his Lord hath made ruler over his household, to give them meat in due season? Blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find so doing. Verily I say unto you, that ye shall make him ruler over all his goods. But and if that evil servant shall say in his heart, My Lord delayeth his coming, and shall begin to smite his fellow servants, and to eat and drink with the drunken, the Lord of that servant shall come in a day when he looketh not for him, and in an hour that he is not aware of, and shall cut him asunder, and appoint him his portion with the hypocrites. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth." The Bible tells us here that in the days in which we live, there are two words that should describe or define the work and activity of the child of God. One is watching, the other is working. When I was a boy, we didn't stay all night with others very often, and we were always at home at night. But if my parents did go away, we would most of the time stay with my dad's mom and dad, my grandparents, my grandma and grandpa Fugate. And most always, my dad, before he left, he would remind me of the chores that he expected to be done when he returned. He may say, son, this week would be a good week for you to get the barn cleaned out. This would be a good week for you to get work done in the strawberry field. Or maybe you need to get some work done on the fencing around the hog lots. Or get the grass cut. And he would give me always chores to do. You see, busy boys stay out of trouble. Boys that don't have work and responsibility to do, they often get into trouble. For a long time, I thought my dad was raising strawberries and raising hogs, and my dad was just raising boys and using those things to keep us busy. Well, I would put off first day or two they were gone, and I enjoyed playing basketball, and a bunch of us fellas there where we live would get together, and sometimes we'd play all evening. We'd play till darkness fell and enjoyed playing. My grandmother would say, "Now, Jeffrey, your daddy will be back in a day or two. You better have those chores done. You know you're going to get in trouble. Now, I can only do so much." My grandmother was always pleading, don't give that boy a whipping. And grandma was always pleading my cause, and my dad would very politely say thank you and go out of sight, and he'd take care of business. But anyway, she was as the Holy Spirit for me. She would remind me, "Now, your daddy will be back. You better get that work done." Well, this passage of Scripture is talking about the same thing. It's talking about the fact that Jesus is going to return, and he's going to return like a thief in the night. Now, he says, by way of illustration, if you knew what night the thief was going to come, you'd watch for him, and you wouldn't let him break up your house. And he said those that don't care and those that don't pay attention, those kind of watchmen, they'd let folks have their house ransacked and everything valuable stolen. And he's telling us as Christians, Jesus is coming again. And you need to be watching for his return. And that watching for his return should be a motivation for your work for him. I'm going to give you several things that you and I ought to be watching for. First of all, we are watching for the Savior. Titus chapter 2, verse number 11, talks about watching for the return of Christ. May I ask you tonight, how long has it been since you've given thought, serious thought, to the fact of Christ's return? Have you thought today that this could be the day that Christ would return? Have you thought that this could be the very month, this could be the very year that Christ would return? If you knew that Jesus Christ was going to return on Sunday night, you'd probably be in church on Sunday morning. You may even go back on Sunday night knowing that you were going to meet him. Titus chapter 2, in addition to Matthew 24, tells us that we're to be watching for the Savior. Second of all, let me say this. We're to be walking by the Scripture. Not only should we be watching for the Savior, we should be walking by the Scripture. I'm going to read to you from 2 Peter. And I love what Peter says about the Word of God, how pure it is, how powerful it is, and wonderful. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse number 19, the Bible says this, "We have also a more sure word of prophecy, wherewith ye do well that ye take heed as unto a light that shineth in a dark place." He said, we have a more sure word of prophecy. He's talking about the written Word of God. And he said, you should pay attention to the Word of God as you do a light that shines in a dark place. You have a place maybe in a basement or a cellar where you have vegetables or canned goods stored, or you maybe have tools and you have them stored out of the way so you know where they are, but it's dark there, and you take a flashlight. When I was a boy, this was a common thing. Take a flashlight and go down there and get a can of kraut, maybe a jar of kraut, or get a jar of green beans or whatever needed for supper. Boy, doesn't that sound good? Those good old canned vegetables, and take that light and go down there. Now, that light was important because I would take that light. I just knew there was a big snake down there. I knew these big spiders, tarantulas down there. Seldom did I ever see anything, but in my mind I did. But that light, it would reveal. Now, the Bible is our light in this dark world. The Bible is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. And as we watch for his return, which motivates our work before his return, we should not only be watching for the Savior, we should be walking by the Scripture. I ask you tonight, do you make decision according to Bible principle? Decisions of purchase, decisions of fellowship, decisions of education, decisions of finances. Do we make our decisions based on the Word of God? To walk in the light of the Scripture is to ask the question at every decision and say, what does the Bible say about that? What does the Bible say about marriage? What does the Bible say about gender? That's an easy one, male and female, and that's all, period. A case closed. That's what the Bible says. This world lost their mind, gone crazy about this foolish, ridiculous imagination that is a filthy imagination. You and I ought to walk by the light of the Scripture. Number three, we ought to be witnessing the signs of the time. Now, this is interesting. Witnessing the signs of the time. More than once, the Lord Jesus referenced, and not only did Jesus reference, but the writers of the New Testament, they referenced the signs of Christ's return. For example, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, the Bible says this in verse number 1, "But of the times and seasons, brethren, we have no need that I write unto you. For yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. For when they shall say, peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. But ye, brethren, are not in darkness, that that day should overtake you as a thief. Ye are all the children of light and the children of the day. We are not of the night nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober. For they that sleep, sleep in the night, and they that be drunken are drunken in the night. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and for an helmet the hope of salvation. For God hath not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ." He's telling us here, we walk in the light. We know Christ is soon to return. You know how we know? We see the signs. The Lord Jesus said, look, when you see the leaves turning, or see the leaves falling, you know that winter is nigh. When you see the grass growing, you know that spring is nigh. We see the signs of the skies, and we'll see a red cloud in the evening, and we'll say it's going to be a beautiful day tomorrow. We understand those signs, those things. As a child of God, we recognize the signs of Christ's return. And I'm not going to go into those. There's a list of those, and they're being fulfilled every day. There is a falling away like never before. Christians just miss church. I mean, just think nothing about it. Just miss church. Not important. Just a falling away. There was a time that America had nearly 60% of its entire population in church on Sunday morning. Now that number is down into the 40s and even less. In fact, they say now less than 50% of Americans call themselves a Christian or even believe in God. Now there's a falling away. We see the signs. What does that tell us? Jesus is coming soon. I believe Jesus could come in this very night. I believe Jesus could come on the beautiful day tomorrow, Sunday, the Lord's day. Jesus is coming soon. And so as we watch for his return, and we work and we prepare for his return, we're watching for the Savior. We're walking by the Scripture. We're witnessing the signs of the time. We're also doing this. We're working to win sinners to Christ. The other day, I was with a group of folks, and the whole group, I was able to just give a whole group, 25, 30 people, the gospel, and then I prayed for them, and I prayed with them, and I told them, if you'd like to receive Christ as Savior, you need to call on the Lord. Believe in your heart, not between you and me, it's between you and God. Believe in your heart and pray the sinner's prayer. Put faith in God. He'll give you salvation. Several of those began to pray out loud, calling on God to forgive them of their sin and to receive them as personal Savior. That's the job of the church, to win the sinner to Christ. So, as we watch and we work, we are watching for the Savior. We are walking by the Scripture. We're witnessing the signs. We're working to win the sinner. Then, we understand we're waiting for the shout. I like this one. We're waiting for the shout. You say, preacher, what does that mean? Well, let me go over here to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, there were folks in the church not only that had died just because of death of old age or of sickness. Some had been martyred for the cause of Christ, and because they were Christians, because they were witnessing, and the hatred the government had toward them, they took their lives. So imagine going to church on Sunday and announcing the names of those that had died for the cause of Christ. I was preaching a few years back in Overland, Ohio, and there's a big college there. It was started by a preacher, and today it's a very liberal place. But in that auditorium they had rented for a conference, as I went in there, I noticed there was a plaque on the foyer wall, and it said, "These died for the cause of Christ, witnessing in China," and had a list of names. Those were friends of people sitting in the pews. Now, folks, listen. Paul was telling the church at Thessalonica what had happened, and he said this, "But I would not have you be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout." I'm listening for the shout of his return. If Christ returned tonight, would you go to heaven or would you be left behind? You don't want to be left behind. Call on Christ now, telling him, "I'm a sinner. I accept you as my Savior." Thanks for watching the program.
Once Elijah, being tempted by Jehovah's foes, led for refuge to the mountains when a storm arose. There he found a safe pavilion where he could reside. "I am hiding
like Elijah
from the storm outside.
I'm hiding like Elijah in the rifted stone.
And sometimes I feel just like him that I can't go on. Then a voice from heaven whispers in the rock abide. I am hiding
like Elijah
from the storm outside. When the clouds of sorrow gather like a raging storm, and the way is dark before me, I shall fear no harm. I am trusting in my Savior, whatsoever betide. I am hiding
like Elijah
from the storm outside.
I'm hiding like Elijah in the rifted stone.
And sometimes I feel just like him that I can't go on. Then a voice from heaven whispers in the rock abide. I'm hiding
like Elijah
from the storm outside. There are many other Christians in this world today. I can feel the Spirit moving when I hear them pray. And it gives me consolation when my soul is tried. I am hiding
like Elijah
from the storm outside. I'm hiding like Elijah in the rifted stone. And sometimes I feel just like him that I can't go on. Then a voice from heaven whispers in the rock abide. I am hiding
like Elijah
from the storm outside.